It is such an enormous privilege to be in your presence, to have been part of this experience, to have been moderator for a year and get to meet so many of you and be in your presbyteries and find out how enormous the love of God is among and between his people. So as we come together following communion this morning, we come as family. I've been reminded so many times, when you get up to preach, remember, these people are your family. And by the way, they also know that you're a ruling elder and not a preacher. As in, when I tried to put the microphone on, I put it on like braces. We serve and live in God's kingdom. We love Jesus. We serve Jesus through the EPC. And we come as family facing a very challenging and difficult culture and world. There is an army arrayed against us in the world. There was a time when another army was arrayed against God's people. And if you have your Bibles, please open to 2 Chronicles 20. I'm going to read verses 2 through 12. I did not expect this passage to be introduced by Tom Ricks, but I am so very grateful. Thank you, Tom. Some men came and told Jehoshaphat, "A vast army is coming against you from Edom, from the other side of the sea. It is already in Hazazon Tamar, that is in Gedi." Alarmed, Jehoshaphat resolved to inquire of the Lord, and he proclaimed a fast for all Judah. The people of Judah came together to seek help from the Lord. Indeed, they came from every town in Judah to seek him. Then Jehoshaphat stood up in front of the assembly of Judah and Jerusalem at the temple of the Lord in the front of the new courtyard, and he said, "O Lord, our God of our fathers, are you not the God who is in heaven? You rule over all the kingdoms of the nations. Power and might are in your hand, and no one can withstand you. O our God, did you not drive out the inhabitants of this land before your people Israel and give it to them to ever for the descendants of Abraham, your friend? They have lived in it and have built in it a sanctuary for your name, saying, 'If calamity comes upon us, whether the sword of judgment or plague or famine, we will stand in your presence before this temple that bears your name and will cry out to you in our distress, and you will hear us and save us.' But now here are men from Ammon, Moab, and Mount Seir, whose territory you would not allow Israel to invade when they came to Egypt. So they turned away and did not destroy them. See how they are repaying us by coming to drive us out of the possession you gave us as an inheritance. O our God, will you not judge them? For we have no power to face this vast army that is attacking us. We do not know what to do, but our eyes are upon you." As we come and realize that God had prepared this place for these people, what did they do when they saw the army coming to attack? Did they turn and run? No. Were they prepared to fight? Probably not. But they focused their eyes on the Lord and on his priorities. And they let his priorities become their priorities. Isn't that what we are all about, EPC? Letting God's priorities become our priorities. So moving down to verse 15, this is what the Lord says to them. "Do not be afraid or discouraged because of this vast army, for the battle is not yours, but God's." Isn't that an incredible piece of wisdom right there? We face an incredibly messy, chaotic world. But the battle is not ours. The battle is God's. We are called to stand. Oh, our God, will you not judge them? For we have no power to face this vast army that is attacking us. We do not know what to do. In virtually every sphere of our lives, we do not know what to do, but our eyes are upon God. I remember a time when my 9-year-old adopted granddaughter, Evelyn White, who is sitting right there, asked me to play school. She was 6 at the time, so I thought, this should be easy. I have a master's. She made me an example and asked me to copy the letters in the blank boxes. Well, I did, only I put a lot of the same letters in the same boxes. You know, I'm an overachiever. And I handed it back to Evelyn. I see her with her red pencil, putting a check in every box that I did. And I went, no! These are just like yours, Evelyn. And she said, no, Grandma Rose, you did not follow the directions. There should only be one letter in each box. And she was so right. I thought this would make her so happy if I put a bunch of letters. No, she wanted me to follow the directions. And I can say that Evelyn gives very good directions. I sat there thinking, Evelyn, my dear granddaughter, I did not follow your directions. And my 6-year-old reminded me of how frequently I do not follow the Lord's directions. Somehow I think, maybe I could make it better. Or maybe I could make it a little bit differently. But my eyes are not focused on the Lord. So what are the Lord's priorities for us in our current cultural landscape? We are living in a cultural and also spiritual wasteland in the United States. We are flooded with words and concepts, ideas, and emotional drama all around us. And in this social culture, we see very little value for human life, even less value if you don't look like me, think like me, and act like me. Nikki Gumbel, founder of Alpha, states, every church should be an inclusive church because God's love is radically inclusive. We should welcome people regardless of their gender, race, or lifestyle. Jesus came to break down every barrier in our society. The real battle starts in my heart and in your heart. Jesus' call for us is crystal clear. Go, make disciples. In Matthew 28, he says, go, baptize, teach. The great I am is with you always, even to the end of the age and to the end of your age. This command crosses all barriers of gender, ethnicity, age, and lifestyle. The world around us does not know what to do. Sadly, many Christians are in the same boat, a world of unpredictable chaos, and we do not know what to do. Oh, our God, will you not judge them? For we have no power to face this vast army that is attacking us in every sphere of our lives. Our only hope is Jesus. Jesus in us and Jesus through us. As with my Evelyn, we go back to putting letters in the boxes. Only this time, we follow the Maker's directions. We make disciples. The Great Commission is a command. It is not an option. So what do? Moving down to 2 Chronicles chapter 20, verse 17, it says, take up your positions and stand firm and see the deliverance that the Lord will give you. You have heard this week, listen, engage, stand. Stand firm in what you believe, because the battle is not yours. That doesn't mean that you're not going to have to stand, and it doesn't mean that you may not end up in some skirmishes, because you will. Satan is out to get us. You will. But those people began to sing and praise. He says, take up your position, stand firm, and see the deliverance the Lord will give you. You personally, you us corporately. Sing to the Lord, praise him for the splendor of his holiness. Praise is our weapon. So if you don't like to sing, that's okay. You can sing anywhere you want, even in your head. But praise is our weapon, and we fight back by singing praise. So we no longer are a Christian nation, and we know that. We have no casual or cultural Christianity. We need to take a position. We need to stand, and we need to praise. In Deuteronomy 32, Moses says, it says, and when Moses had finished speaking all these words to Israel, he said to them, take to heart all the words by which I am warning you today, that you may command them to your children, that they may be careful to do all the words of this law. For it is no empty word for you, but your very life. By this word you shall live long in the land that you are going over Jordan to possess. This is no empty word for you. This is your life and my life. This is mission critical. Command Jesus' words to your children. That is disciples making disciples. That's evangelism. It starts with every one of you, in your home, with your friends, at work, play, wherever and whatever. I don't really care what evangelism tool you use. Just do it. Claim your faith in Jesus and be a doer of God's word and live your faith. Pray for your family and your nation and this world. This vast army, as you know, is driven forward by Satan, the great deceiver. Don't let that army deceive you. The book of James is my favorite book in the Bible. James is my go-to guy. And James says very clearly, don't be deceived and don't deceive yourselves. So don't let that army deceive you or drive you to fear or complacency. Armor up. Look at Ephesians 6, armor up. Armor up every day, because you're going to be in a battle of some sort every day. As Dallas Willard states, to serve God well, we must think straight. Crooked thinking, unintentional or not, always favors evil. And when crooked thinking gets elevated to group orthodoxy, whether religious or secular, there is always, quite literally, hell to pay. That is, hell will take its portion, as it has repeatedly done in the horrors of our world history. Our gospel priorities are mission critical to the kingdom of God on this earth at this time. For such a time as this, you are here. And Jesus can give us, our children, our nation and our world, value, meaning, and purpose. And how will they know that if we are complacently sitting in our pews and then, as my pastor Mark says, walking out through the doors of amnesia? Oh, church, arise. Jesus raised 12 men to be the leaders of the church. Think about the impact of those 12 people. You are in this room because those 12 men were faithful to the Lord and their call from him. Our role is to make disciples, to raise the future leaders of God's kingdom here on earth, to equip leaders to take up their position and stand with Jesus. What does that look like? You have heard so many options this week already, and there's more to come this afternoon. A little bit about what it looks like where I live and in my church is that we raise and equip young pastors and leaders through a cohort. My pastor Mark and I have led 8 cohorts with about 4 people in each, and we meet weekly for 90 minutes for 9 months. That's a huge commitment, but we love our young people, and we have assisted in their spiritual growth, in their preaching ability, and in their leadership development, and also in their character formation. Some of those things which they don't necessarily receive in seminary. And by the way, this is my commercial. This morning and this afternoon, the EPSD Ministerial Vocation Committee is launching a pilot in a cohort in July, and you can hear about that. It is EBL, Effective Biblical Leadership 3, and it's called Pastoral Health and Effectiveness, and it will be delivered 3 times today. If you're interested in a cohort, and I would strongly recommend that you do that, or that you take that information home to one of your younger growing pastors or leaders. We intentionally mentor and coach our leaders. Mark and I do that over a long period of time, not just 9 months. We invest our lives because we love our new young leaders. And they are the future of the church. I am not the future of this church. I am probably a bit of the present, but probably more of the past. Our young leaders, your young leaders, you young leaders in this room, you are the future of this church. Grow, be equipped, and be ready to serve. We see different and interesting new ways to invest in our young leaders. For instance, when Ellis and Rachel White had their first child, who is my granddaughter Evelyn, although Ellis and Rachel are not actually my children, we just adopted them. I started meeting weekly with Rachel when Evelyn was probably, I don't know, a few weeks to a few months old. And we met weekly, and then Ezra came along, and we continued to meet weekly. And then Rachel went to work, and I started taking care of the kids a bit of the time after school, during COVID, those sorts of things, and we adopted them and became their surrogate grandparents, since the rest of their family still lives in England. Both of the kids are in school. I don't see them as much as I used to, but I'm still Grandma Rose. Currently, I give 1 day a week, about 8 to 10 hours, to be with 2 young children, ages 4 and 2. They also have a 6-month-old baby at home. Their dad is a state representative. He's been gone from home for 3 months since the baby was like maybe 2 months old. So mom has her hands full. So I spend a day playing with the 4-year-old and the 2-year-old. They love to read. They love to play. They really love to work in the yard. And I have taught my almost four-year-old, how to weed. And he's very good at it. And he will spend anywhere from 2 to 4 straight hours in the yard working with me because it's so much fun. We have great conversations, and we just have a wonderful time together. I also taught him how to use clippers. I didn't bring pictures, but we have some very interesting shrubbery because I didn't always have my eyes on him. So we have some trees that are a little wonky looking. But you know what? Mom and Dad don't care, and Grandma Rose and Rory have a wonderful time together. And he knows how to pray. He knows how to pray the Lord's Prayer. He knows and prays for Grandma Rose and his daddy in their work. So I'm just giving you some hints, because not everybody is under 40 in this room. Some of you are gray hairs like me. Don't think that because you are of a retirement age that you can retire, because that is not, I don't see that anywhere in the Bible. And I just praise the Lord for that, because I'm 77 and he called me to this role. And so I think that all of you out there, there is something unique and interesting that God's called you to. So if you're not quite sure what calling looks like, and I call it calling with a big C, there are ways that you can invest in people. Just look around. One of Pastor Mark's other sweet phrases is, head on a swivel. So always be looking. Who's the next person that you can mentor and disciple? If you're unsure about calling, let me recommend to you the best book I have ever read on calling. It's written by Oz Guinness, and it's called The Call. And it is phenomenal. I also believe it is not optional. We have a command on our lives from Jesus. Go to the next door person who lives in your neighborhood. Go to the person next to you in church. They may not be believers. Go to a child of a young leader. Go to the wife or the husband of a leader or pastor. Make sure that people are supported and encouraged in their ministry, because that could be your ministry. And let me tell you, the rewards are far, far greater than anything you could possibly do or give. So what will it cost? It'll cost. It will cost you at least time and travel. It could be inconvenient and uncomfortable. Your disciple making might be with a teenager, which sort of strikes terror to my heart. Or it could be a middle schooler. It will challenge you to keep your focus on God. And I can't tell you how many times I have said, oh my God, I do not know what to do, but my eyes are upon you. Reflect back to communion. Think deeply about what it cost Jesus to save you from yourself, from your sin, from eternal death. It cost him his life. We tend to take that for granted. We tend to think, you know, that was Jesus' job. That's why God sent him here. His job was to come, preach for a few years, and die on the cross. We tend to take that rather casually. I would encourage you to think about that very deeply. Really examine God's call on your life. You just came from communion. You just committed yourself once again to follow Jesus. Think it through clearly. He did not want to follow his Father's directions, but he did it. He chose to do it, even taking on all our sin in his death and resurrection. So I encourage you to reflect back on the last 2 days. How have you been sharpened? What has God taught you, engaged you in, and led you forward by in the last 2 days that you weren't there when you came to this place? Do you think straight? Or do you get easily confused by the chaotic thinking that is around the world? Do you get confused by the radical right, even in Christianity? Do you get upset and frustrated by the radical left that's in the community and in the world around us? This is not your battle. This is God's battle. Stand up, stand firm, stand strong in the Lord, because it is going to count. I do believe, and I'm not prophetic, but I do believe that more and more we as Christians are going to be persecuted. It is going to cost us more than it did when I was a child and people went to church because that was the culturally acceptable thing to do. Don't get deceived. Don't be deflected by crooked thinking. Examine your thinking before the Lord, before you speak. Are you being personally transformed into the likeness of Christ? I would assume that every one of you would want to say yes, but we get easily distracted. I get easily distracted And I find there are times when my thinking is not straight and I need to come back to the Lord. And fortunately, what he does for me, and I'm sure he does for you, and if he doesn't or isn't, then ask him to, because he will. I always say, please, Lord, give me 30 seconds to think before I say anything. 30 seconds. That's a very short amount of time, but it's a perfect opportunity for the Holy Spirit to engage you in straight thinking before you open your mouth. Are you now ready to share Jesus with someone you care about? Or maybe somebody you don't even know, and make a disciple? Can you clearly articulate your call? God has a definite call on every person in this room. You are not here because you're the wife of the pastor or a ministry spouse. You are here because God called you here, because he has a message for you. You have a call. If you're not clear about what that is, seek the mind of Christ and his call on your life. There are many wise and wonderful people in this room. I have not met every one of you personally, but those of you whom I have met over the past year and this week, you are phenomenal people. God has raised a great army, and this is you. And we are so blessed. Calling has no gender, no race, no age limit. Open your heart to the loving Father, your loving Father, your almighty King, and your Savior and Lord, Jesus Christ. Hear his voice. Come. Follow him. Come, Lord Jesus. Let's pray together. Father, you have brought every one of us here for a purpose. We didn't know necessarily what it was when we arrived, but if we haven't found it yet, we're going to find it today, because you don't want any one of us to walk away having missed your call. So, Lord, I just pray for this body of believers. I thank you for every one of them who is here. I thank you, Lord, for this church, for their generosity and their welcome spirit, and for the blessing they have been. And I praise you, Lord Jesus, that as we walk out of these doors, I ask you, God, do not let one of us walk out through the doors of amnesia. Remind us over and over, Lord, who you are and who you have called us to be, and may we bless your holy name. In Jesus' name, amen.